And welcome to Lillington Free Church this morning. I'd like to welcome any visitors and first timers this morning. Please stay for a coffee or tea or biscuits after the service. It'd be lovely to meet you. I have a couple of notices. Please, can we have any cakes? Anybody who can make cakes or donate cakes for the King's Coronation event, which is on the 7th of May. Bring and share lunch and things like that sounds wonderful. If you could see Jan for more information, that'd be lovely. So bring or buy any cakes, see Jan for information. Thank you. We had an amazing faith walk yesterday, which was very well attended with 45 people. So that was amazing. Thank you very much for all who did that and attended and walked. That was brilliant. Thank you. Now, our very own Emily, starring in Oliver Twist. So, Thursday the 29th of June and Saturday the 1st of July. Yeah, thank you. At Rother Street, Stratford-upon-Avon. So it is 7:30 on the Thursday the 29th, and then Saturday I have a matinee at 3 p.m. and then I have an evening performance at 6:30 p.m. It'd be amazing if we could all attend and support our Emily for that. But thank you and congratulations and well done for that. So thank you. So please can we all stand to open the Bible, and can we also make sure our electronic devices are all on silent or turned off. Thank you.
Good morning. And if we can please say the words in bold. Hopefully. Today we rejoice in the salvation of the world. Christ is risen. Let us arise in him. Christ enters new life. Let us live in him. Let us sing our first hymn together. How deep the Father's love for us.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Christ, you are risen from the dead. We are risen with you. May our life never deny this eternal life, this peace and hope and joy. Praise and glory to the God of life, who is stronger than all kinds of death. Amen. Let us say together the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. One day, John Wesley was walking with a troubled man who expressed his doubt as to the goodness of God. He said, "I do not know what I shall do with all this worry and trouble." At the same moment, Wesley saw a cow looking over a stone wall. "Do you know," asked Wesley, "why that cow is looking over the wall?" "No," said the man who was worried. Wesley said, "The cow is looking over the wall because it cannot see through it. And that is what you must do with your wall of trouble. Look over it and avoid it." Through the service today, we're going to explore the meaning of faith and how faith enables us to look past our circumstances and focus on Christ. And what I'd like you to do now is to turn to the person beside you and maybe say a trouble that you have had in the past that's been overcome by your faith. So if you turn to the person beside you, and then we'll have the Roman reporter in a moment. This is coming on and off with the words. Oh, is it? Oh, great. Okay, are there any brave people that Rob's going to pounce on now, who is our roaming reporter, to find out some of your stories? Diane, you're first. Go for it.
Oh, hello, yeah. Well, just over 20 years ago, 23 years to be exact, I had an aggressive cancer, and it came from nowhere, rogue. And nothing in the family, nothing in it, you know, wasn't Eastern based or anything, so nothing hereditary, and knocked me for six a bit, you know, as it would. But at the time, I wasn't going to church. And I found out later that several churches had been praying for me. And I didn't find that out until quite a long time after. And I survived, and 23 years later, I'm cancer free.
Thank you. When I was at work, we had a dear friend called Carrie, and everybody, she had to be in isolation for 6 months, and she was, if she hadn't have had the stem cells that were given to her, she would have not survived, but she did, and she had to be isolated from her family right through over Christmas and everything. It was very sad, and I prayed to God then, and it was a silly prayer, really, but it's something I've always stuck by. I said, I'm sure other people were praying for her as well. She's got a lovely family. But I did say, Lord, I will never, ever take my cross off if you save Carrie's life. And she's still alive today. She's moved away, but we write regularly, and she's still doing fine. Yeah, there you go.
Thank you. I don't usually share like this, but this was yesterday. So Jenny and I went to the well. People know about the well. And the day before, I actually slipped and twisted my knee a little bit. Now, I have a bit of arthritis in that knee, but I was limping. And in the morning, it was feeling a little bit more anxious. And I was thinking, well, the way this is going, I'm not sure whether it's going to permit me to do what I feel I should be doing. And there was a chance for prayer. I went to, I went up and had people praying around me, and two things. The pain was subsiding. On a scale of 1 to 10, it's moved a couple of points. It feels a lot better this morning. But also, a lady there said she had a passage for me, and I hadn't heard of this before. I wrote it down. It was in Isaiah, and basically it says, "I will bind up the weak in knee," and she said, "This is for you." And I said, "Yes, thank you." And it's the Lord saying, yes, it's going to ache, it's going to twinge, but you're going to be able to do what you need to do.
Yeah. I can definitely sympathize with the knees. And of course, the main healer is, of course, our Lord. And for many, I'm sure he hears quite a few prayers. Particularly from my bedside. It is something which is very difficult to live with as well, the pain. And for many others, I'm sure you've experienced what pain is like in probably other parts of your body or what. But definitely to be given that piece of scripture and to be told something of words of encouragement is really what we are all about as brothers and sisters. Together, which is amazing. So thank you for sharing really personal stories there. We're now going to sing our next hymn, which is thinking about the many reasons that actually we do love our Lord God and what he's done for us. And just before we do that, you just got me thinking about a piece of scripture in Jeremiah chapter 29. "For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and to harm you, plans to give you hope and a future." And I think when we do perhaps get down in life with illnesses and different things that happen, we just need to look to the fact the Lord's got it covered. So 10,000 Reasons, Matt Redmond's wonderful song.
Yeah.
And now is the time to give your gifts to this church. God, accept these gifts and with them our lives to be used in service for you through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. Our next hymn is Because He Lives. Barbara's going to read our gospel reading.
and from the New Testament, it's John 19 to 31. Oh, sorry, chapter 20, 19 to 21. When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." But Thomas, who was called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the marks of the nails in his hand and put my finger in the mark of the nails and my hand in his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book, but these are written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing you may have life in his name. Amen.
I thought I was doing very well, not to make a mistake. Don't worry. Oh dear. Forgot I'm attached. Okay. So today's theme is obviously about faith. And faith can be defined by our human response to divine revelation. It is believing God's word. Martin Luther King once said, "Faith is the first step, even when you don't see the whole staircase." In other words, faith is a journey that you begin without knowing or seeing everything. From the Gospel of John reading we've just heard, we learn about the disciples that were staying behind closed doors. It's not difficult to understand why. Only 2 days earlier, Jesus had been executed. Jesus was then, his body laid in a tomb. And the disciples, as you can imagine, were numb with fear, afraid of persecution from the Jewish community. But then on that Easter morning, the news began to spread that Jesus was alive. The tomb was empty, as Mary Magdalene found out. And then Jesus appears to his disciples, and he shows them his hands and his side. And he does this to prove beyond a shadow of a doubt that it is really him. The disciples realized that their lives would never be the same. Now, maybe you've had something that's happened in your life and you knew things would never be the same. Perhaps it was the first day starting a new job, the first day after your wedding, or the first day after the death of a loved one. Whatever it was, that change would mean for you that things would never be the same. And for the disciples who had spent so much time with Jesus, this was a massive change. Their leader was no longer physically with them. And how could they spread the gospel by themselves? How would the people react to them after their leader Jesus had been crucified and buried? Big questions that generate thoughts of doubt, perhaps, rather than faith. In John chapter 20, verses 24 to 29, we then begin to find John's purpose in writing. which is to awaken his readers to faith in Jesus. This is where the story shifts to Thomas. For some reason, he was absent when the other disciples were present. And John does not tell us as to the reason why. But soon after, he is with the other disciples, and they tell him the miraculous news. Jesus has arisen. We have seen the Lord. And how does Thomas respond? Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands and put my finger in the mark of the nails and my hand in his side, I will not believe. So, of course, a week later, when Thomas is in the house with the disciples, Jesus appears again. Jesus then turns to Thomas, put your finger here. Reach out your hand. Stop doubting and believe. Or perhaps stop being unbelieving. Show yourself to be a believer. These words, according to many leading commentators, focuses the failure of Thomas. He had received this apostolic witness, which is the basis for faith, but had failed to trust it. Don't know about you, but I've always felt really bad for Thomas. He had to believe sight unseen, and probably any of the others would have had the same struggle. And yet, all we know is that Thomas is referred to as Doubting Thomas. I think I'd hate to be remembered only for my greatest moment of doubt, because I've had them. And I could be doubting Julie very easily. And I guess a lot of us could be something very much similar. But as much as Thomas sort of gets this label as a disciple who didn't believe, he's always been my favourite. Because out of all of them, he's the one I think most of us can relate to. Because most of us understand what it is like to live between doubt and faith. During COVID, many of us lived between faith and doubt. We wanted to trust God and that he would protect us through it. But then some of us doubted God. And as there were so many people dying, it was difficult to believe that God would see us through it. And for those that did not survive, obviously God had different plans for that person. But Thomas then confesses his faith in Jesus. The experience of Thomas makes the point that faith is not always, perhaps not even typically, a straightforward affair. At times, faith is a battle with unbelief, and at times, pretty agonizing. Jesus knows this agonizing of faith Thomas has been experiencing, and this is why he does not dismiss him. Jesus knows exactly what has been going through his mind, as he does our own minds. He knows our doubts in all their detail and circumstance. You could say, like Thomas, I have had moments of doubts as well. And doubt is often a key part of a journey of faith. It's a stop along the way that most of us make more than once. And I would hate to think how many stops I've had along the way, but I've had them. And when we find ourselves there, we begin to question things. And it's okay to be a Christian and question things, because basically that's an indication that we're not a bad Christian or a disbeliever. If anything, it's a sign that we're taking our relationship with God seriously. Seriously enough that we're letting ourselves be honest. We are letting ourselves start a journey without exactly knowing where we're going to perhaps end. But it can be what shakes us up. It pushes us out of the doors of our once comfortable places and into a new and better world. The assurance of faith means that Thomas came through his doubts into clear and firm conviction. In verse 28, Thomas says, "My Lord and my God." This makes him the first person in the Gospels perhaps even the first person in all of history, to confess Jesus not only as Lord, but as God. Doubting Thomas, or better yet, honest Thomas, becomes faithful Thomas, becomes bold Thomas, becomes believing Thomas. This is where honesty with God leads. This is the outcome of an open confession of doubt. It's not a pretend faith. It's 100% genuine, that issues from the deepest depths of our souls. It's a faith that transforms our lives, and it's what we all want as Christians. I'd like to pray a prayer with you now that you can also pray to yourself. And it may be a prayer that you're saying for the first time, but more than likely it's a prayer where you're renewing your faith and you're reminding yourselves about what Christ has done for each and every one of us. And whatever might be holding you back in your faith, the risen Christ offers himself in order to bridge the gap. Doubts, fears, or questions, Jesus responds to all through his presence, a presence communicated by the Holy Spirit. And all you have to do is to confess your faith. Christ waits to receive us all. Let us pray. Dear God, I come before you today with a humble heart and surrender my life to you. I believe that Jesus Christ was born free of sin, died on the cross as a payment for my own sin, and rose 3 days later. I believe in your gift of salvation and eternal life because of the sacrifice of Jesus Christ. God, today I repent and turn from my old way of life. Because of your mercy and grace, I can have childlike faith. Today, I ask for new life through Jesus Christ and the power of the Holy Spirit. Thank you, God, for forgiving me and making me brand new. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. We've now got our next hymn, which is In Christ Alone. Anyone who's prayed that prayer for the first time, and if you want to talk to anyone about it, whether it be elders or myself, please feel free to do so when we have coffee afterwards.
Thank you.
On the screen is the response to the prayer, hopefully, our intercession prayers. So, Lord, to whom we can go, you have the words of eternal life. Let us pray. Lord, thank you for last night's sleep, and thank you for today. Help us to waste none of today's hours and to miss none of today's opportunities. Thank you for the gifts you have given us individually and collectively, and help us to use them to further your kingdom here on earth. Eyes to see and perceive, ears to hear and listen, hands to work and create, minds to think and innovate, memories to remember and learn from, and hearts to love and worship. Lord, to whom can we go? You have the words of eternal life. Lord, we confess that we have not always followed your words. There have been moments when we chose other options. We chose to join in the gossip and not to speak out on behalf of the misunderstood. We chose to take sides with the strong because we feared the consequences of being found alongside the weak. We fired back a text in anger. We hit send on an email in the heat of the moment. We spoke a harsh word of judgment, and we regret the fact that what has been said can't be taken back. We allowed pride to get the better of us, and we ask for your forgiveness and mercy, Lord. We thank you that you do not treat us as our sins deserve, and your love and your word permit a new start. As we move on from this place, may others see a difference in us. May we surprise others with the gift of forgiveness and our capacity to move on and make fresh starts. Lord, to whom can we go? You have the words of eternal life. Lord God, we pray for our community, for teachers as they bring to fruition their preparations for the start of the exam season, for our children and young people as they perform their exams. Please, Lord, settle their nerves and help them to do well. For healthcare and social workers in their mission to improve the well-being of those who are sick and unwell. For those in the armed forces as they prepare for their next challenges in a dangerous world. For volunteers, carers, and those who undertake work for which they are not paid. Lord, guide and inspire our community in all we do this week and beyond. Lord, to whom can we go? You have the words of eternal life. Lord, we pray for all people who are in trouble and fear today, for those who are sad because someone they have loved has died. We particularly think of our brothers and sisters in Sudan and also Ukraine. For those who are anxious because someone is ill or in pain. For those who are lonely because someone they love is not there for them. Lord, bless those who are tired because they have too much to do. Those who are struggling with finance or are facing the prospect of unemployment. Those who are unhappy because of any unkind word or action. Lord, surround those in need with your wisdom, your spirit, your healing, and your life-giving peace. Lord, to whom can we go? You have the words of eternal life. Lord, you call us to follow in your footsteps. Help us to know what this looks like in each situation where we find ourselves. Help us to know when following you means having faith and not doubting. When it means breaking down the barriers that divide people from each other in the homes where we live, the places where we work, and the communities where we worship. We grieve the fact that our world is divided, and we ask that you work powerfully in our small lives and our big world to break down the walls that divide. break down the walls within our own lives which hold us back from reaching out to others, which prevent us from seeing the best in other people, in other cultures, and which stop your love getting in and your blessing getting out. Lord, to whom we can go, you have the words of eternal life. Lord, in gratitude, in deep gratitude for this moment, this place, this world, we give ourselves to you. Take us out to live as changed people because we've been touched by the living Lord and cannot remain the same. Ask much of us, expect much of us, enable much by us, and encourage many through us. Living Lord, accept our lives and accept our prayers this day and every day. You have the words of eternal life, and in you we trust. Amen. Our final hymn is, I like to call a golden oldie, but it's When I Survey the Wondrous Cross. Just should have said at the beginning of the service, I know we've a visitor today, so very welcome. Please stop for coffee and tea at the end as well. We go into the world to walk in God's light, to rejoice in God's love, and to reflect God's glory. Amen. Let's say the grace to one another. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all forevermore. Amen. Amen.